Goedendag. Samenzweren. Conspiracy is het woord in het Engels. Samenzweringen in de wereld. Bestaan ze echt, bestaan ze niet echt? Iemand die in ieder geval heeft bijgedragen aan het hele, de hele mode van de conspiracy is Robert Anton Wilson. Hij is de auteur van bijvoorbeeld de Illuminati-trilogie. Velen van u zullen dat boek gelezen hebben. Heil Discordia is de kreet die erin komt. Heil Discordia. Heel veel mensen die in de 70e jaren, 80e jaren kennis gemaakt hebben met zijn boeken, zagen plotseling de wereld als een samenzwering. Niks is toevallig, alles is geregeld. De moord op Kennedy, wat er ook in de wereld gebeurde, allemaal conspiracy. Nou, we gaan vandaag praten met Robert Anton Wilson. Hij is in Amsterdam vanwege de Cannabis Cup en over zijn nieuwste boek, Out of Control. Welkom, Bob, we say, yeah? Robert Anton Wilson, your latest book is called...
I'm sorry, what a time to pick her up. Everything is under control.
Everything is under control. Ah, that is a reassuring title, so to... Wait a second.
Well, it depends on how you look at it. Everything is under control in English means everything is okay. Yep. Everything is under control also suggests that somebody is controlling everything, something you don't know about. So it has a double meaning. Yeah. I like it a lot.
You like it. In Holland at the moment we have a television series called Big Brother. And the concept is they put 10 people in a house, very closed off, no television, and they watch them for 100 days. And they have some games like every 2 weeks they have to vote if one of the people has to leave. And the person who stays the longest or makes it, he gets like $250,000 or something like that. It's called Big Brother. And there's cameras all over the place, even in the toilets. It's not aired, and all the time you can watch it on internet and on TV. So it's a little group
session.
Cameras
are in the toilets?
Oh yeah, those are not aired, but they want, you see, if people would know there is a place where they can do things without being seen, kill each other, whatever, so there is a... no privacy. Is that where we're going to with Big Brother? No privacy?
That's your God. You mean is the world moving in that direction? I don't think so. Nobody's going to put a camera in my house. I won't let them.
Well, but they might put one in your street. They probably have police cameras in your street, or not?
Well, then again, there's three different companies are planning to build hotels in space in the next 20 years. After we got hotels in space, the next thing is space colonies. And I figure as soon as the space colonies start getting taken over by earthly governments, then you move out of space colonies and build ones further up.
So you say there is an escape route?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Yeah. They've always moved to the perimeter. And before they build space colonies, there's always lots of area in South America, Africa, and so on that nobody has any control over. So if you don't mind fighting off snakes and tigers...
You have a chance of escaping.
Yeah.
Now, your book is about it's like a encyclopedia of the conspiracy theories and conspiracies in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Are there many?
Are there many conspiracies?
Yeah.
I would wager there are 24 major conspiracies at any given second. They're all
every
fighting
second.
One another.
They're fighting, the 24 major. Now, in Holland, we have like the Bilderberg Group. You've heard about it, you've written about it.
I think I got an entry in my encyclopedia.
Yeah, that's an entry, yes. And when they said that these big Dutch industrialist with the royal family, they all conspire to do what, actually?
Take over the world.
Yeah, but what does that mean, take over? What, financially, morally?
Financially. Yeah, but they're not the only ones. We've got the Rockefellers in my country. And in Italy, we got the what's left of the Padoue gang, not all of whom went to jail, most of whom are still doing very well, especially the Vatican Bank.
Yeah. Now, these conspiracies have at least some traces in the real world, because this guy from the Vatican Bank was found hanging on a bridge in London, yeah, wasn't it?
Roberto Calvi, yeah.
Yes. So that's, you might say there is a trace of that this conspiracy is real. Are all conspiracies real?
Oh no, there are more People have a great talent for inventing imaginary conspiracies. I would say my book.
People have a great. Wait a moment. You have a great talent for inventing imaginary,
well,
because you wrote the book. You started the whole idea of conspiracies.
Oh, you're talking about my Illuminatus?
Yes.
I don't think I invented anything in that book. I think they're all come. I have less. I deserve less credit than I get. Most of that was just collecting crazy theories that were running around America at the time the novel was written. There's hardly anything in Illuminatus. The one thing I remember inventing.
You mean that all those stories about German people doing neo-Nazis and that there was something happening?
Oh,
that
there were a few things invented in the book, but most of the theories, like the English bankers conspiracy, the Illuminati, a lot of people believe in all those things.
But do you believe in it? That's more important.
Well, I don't believe in anything. I think belief is the death of intelligence. Once you believe in something, you don't have to think about it anymore. The more things you have firm beliefs about, the less you got to think about. When you have firm beliefs about everything, you don't have to think at all anymore. Then you're ready to join a cult or a religion.
Mm-hmm. But the people that read the book, they kind of joined the cult. And when I say Hail Discordia, it was Hail Discordia. That became a little. When I was young in Delft, people would greet each other like that. Hey, we know. We're in the knowing of the Illuminati story. And we felt we were part of the conspiracy by knowing. But now, these days, there's still things happening that are unexplainable. A lady who died in Paris. The young Kennedy who landed his plane in the North Atlantic. Do you think those things are accidental, or there is?
I don't think this. I haven't seen enough real evidence to think either of them was a real
conspiracy.
But on the other hand, I wouldn't deny it dogmatically. More evidence might come forth at any time. The Kennedy thing really looks like an accident. The Lady Di thing, I'm a little bit suspicious. After all, she was about to marry an Arab, but if I know anything about the English ruling class, the idea
that wasn't
the idea that the future king would have an Arab father-in-law is enough to drive them up the walls.
Yeah. Well, he was the son of a very rich shopkeeper, you could say. So maybe that wasn't suitable. But all these stories about the place being portentous, you know, the specific bridge and the specific place.
Oh, it's connected with the Merovingians.
Yeah.
And the Merovingians, there have been lots of books claiming the Merovingians are descended from Jesus Christ and Mary Magdalene.
Yeah, that is the blood lineage of the Merovian, which were the French kings.
Yeah, but there's an opposing theory by Gerard de Sade claiming the Merovingians are descended from extraterrestrials from a star and this planet in the system of the star Sirius.
And that links them probably to the Great Pyramids, where Sirius.
Oh, sure, yeah.
Yeah, but this becomes like. How many people in America are into conspiracies?
I think almost everybody now.
Yes.
Well, the United States government. I don't know about other governments. I know a little bit about them, but I know more about the United States government. The United States government has been caught in so many flat-footed lies over the last 30 years. But if anybody in the government says anything, the majority of your population assumes right away that it's a lie, which I think is a healthy condition. I think the government has been lying all through its whole career. It's, I think, a good thing that people are getting more suspicious of it. When people trust their government, that's when you're really in trouble.
So you don't trust the government in the U.S.?
I don't trust any government.
Oh, good. Thank you. We're in Amsterdam. And I tend to agree with you that at least you have to be very critical. It's a good attitude to not take their word for it. But in actual life, I mean, what do you think proves that the government is an unreliable operation?
You want the first 1,000 reasons or the first 10,000?
Well, take a few. I mean, we're here for the Cannabis Cup and the war on drugs. Is that a proof that the government is a...
Well, you mean the war on some drugs?
The war on some drugs, yes.
Yeah, they're not warring.
Not on tobacco, but on...
They're not warring on all drugs. As a matter of fact, right now there are 8 Christian scientists awaiting sentence for refusing to use drugs. We got a war on some drugs, and we got a war for some drugs at the same.
You have
time.
To explain that Christian Scientist is a belief system where people say you can cure yourself. And you basically should not take artificial medicine, which we call drugs.
The faith, according to Christian Scientists, faith healing works best or only if you don't use any medicine at all, rely entirely on faith. Religious Science, which is a splinter off that, they say you can combine, take medicine and use faith both. But Christian Scientists say it shows weakness of faith if you take medicine. So they refuse to take the drugs that are being pushed by the big pharmaceutical companies. And there are about 8 of them that stood trial in the last 10 years. I don't know where the case, a couple of them are in jail. Some of the cases are being appealed. So what's really going on is the government is trying to force us to use expensive drugs that could be monopolized by the big pharmaceutical companies and prevent us from using cheap drugs we might grow in our own backyard.
Like hemp.
Like hemp, for instance, yeah. There's a new drug for AIDS. It costs $1,200 a dose. You need to take it every day. Who can afford that? Only the fabulously rich.
Yeah, or where there is a system like...
Supposing there was a new drug for AIDS you could grow in your backyard, the government would never approve it.
But they approved. Consistently being said by people that invented machines, miracle cure machines, and we know there have been a few around, electrical devices. They always said that the American Medical Association has, in fact, stopped them in marketing those devices. So there is a medical conspiracy then?
Well, it's when you talk about conspiracy, there's ambiguity because there's an awful lot of genuine stupidity around. As J.R. Bob Dobbs says, you know how dumb the average guy is? Well, mathematically, by definition, half of them are even dumber than that. And, you know, George Carlin, the philosopher Carlin, he's pointed out, you take a notebook with you when you go out any day, and every time you hear something particularly stupid, you make a note. By the end of the average day, you'll have about 40 notes. But then the thing is, they're not all that dumb. Some of them are just full of shit. They're pretending to be dumb because they want to sell you something. That's mostly the advertisers, the insurance salesmen, and the politicians. They're not as dumb as they act. They're just full of shit.
Yeah, but isn't that the American dream? You make money.
Oh, sure, yeah. But then there's a third problem, which some people are not stupid and they're not full of shit. They're just fucking crazy. It's very hard to distinguish who's really stupid, who's full of shit, and who's fucking crazy.
Take an example, then.
Well, okay, I think Bill Clinton isn't stupid. So he's either full of shit or fucking crazy. I don't think he's fucking crazy, therefore he must be full of shit.
Robert Anton Wilson's logic, yeah. Bill Gates.
Bill Gates, he's not stupid, obviously. You can't be stupid and get that rich. He's full of shit. Donald Trump, on the other hand, is fucking crazy.
You have an opinion. But give me an idea. How many of your books have been sold in the States? Or worldwide?
All of my books altogether?
Yeah?
I don't know, somewhere over a million, I think.
So there's a million people in the world who at least...
had their minds ruined by me.
Yeah, well, my mind was ruined a bit because when I read your book, I started looking at these things in town and what's happening. I thought, hey, why is this happening? Why is that happening? And at the time, John Perry Barlow, whom you probably know, yes?
No, I don't. As a matter of fact, I know a lot of people who know him.
So okay, John Perry Barlow said, well, there is no conspiracy, but there is a lot of auto-conspiracy. People come together and by chance, well, not by chance, by the force, and then they do things that can be interpreted as a conspiracy.
Did he tell you to use the force, Luke?
No. He didn't tell me the force. No. In those days, we used little pills called LSD, and they gave us the force. But him and me, at one time, we were in Death Valley, and we came from Vegas, and where we bought a lot of cheap watches at some fair, like 20 or so. And we took some LSD in Death Valley, really impressive. Moon and the sun was really, and we buried the watches, and we really thought we buried time at that time. 10 years later, I went back. Yeah, about 10 years. I went back and I tried to find the place where we buried the watches, and they weren't there. So I'm sure. Yeah, so these things happen. At some time, we believe that we have powers beyond the obvious, and your books are about that. That people believe the Illuminati believe they had some power. Do you think there's powers around that we not normally recognize or admit?
That's a rather vague question. But
okay,
yes.
Magic.
Yeah, I think people have all sorts of powers they don't generally use because they don't realize that, except in emergencies. Most people have telepathy, ESP, whatever you want to call it. Most people have that in times of emergency, and it's usually connected with members of their family. It seems to run on lines of genetics.
Yeah, if your family is in danger.
But then again, sometimes it skips genetics entirely. My father-in-law, many, many, many years ago, before I was even born, my wife told me this story. She remembered it from a child, that he was out dozing in the hammock. Suddenly he sat up wide awake and he said, "Calvin Coolidge is dead." When it came over the radio about a half hour later, Calvin Coolidge was a president in the 1920s. I don't know how the hell that one worked, but usually it's somebody in your own family you get a message like that about.
Yeah. Now the people in the craft.
Didn't care a damn about Calvin Coolidge.
Yeah. But the people in the craft, the witchcraft, and there's many in America and in England, they say they communicate in some kind of space, and they do this, and they train themselves to communicate, to send messages to other people, like simple messages, "Call me, please," you know, and we know all that happens a lot, that you have the feeling, oh, I have to call John.
You
or whatever.
Called me this morning when I was just about to call you.
Yeah. Ah, magic, yeah. But that was basically because we said 12 o'clock, so those things are...
I didn't remember what time you said.
Okay, well, I called you and I said...
I thought I was late. I thought I was supposed to call you at 11, but I wasn't awake at 11.
Oh, that's fine. So, coming back on the American thing, the war on drugs is one of the conspiracies I consider important.
The war on some drugs. If you say the war on drugs, you're buying into the rhetoric of the establishment. They want you to think they're warring on drugs. Once you realize they're only warring on some drugs, then you start thinking a little bit more clearly, and that's the last thing they want.
Yeah. But talking about drugs, has...
Like we. When people talk about the government, they say we.
Yeah.
All through the 60s, people going around saying, we should get out of Vietnam. I was never in Vietnam. Why are we in Vietnam? We weren't in Vietnam.
Because we identify, yeah.
The fucking government was in Vietnam.
Yeah. Some of the boys were there.
Well, yeah, but they were so they were enslaved.
Yeah. But talking about some drugs, have those same drugs inspired you to your life?
Oh, well, some of them have anyway, yeah.
Would you say you would have written better books or worse books without it?
Oh, I think without marijuana and LSD, my books would be very, very different. I don't know if they'd be much worse. They wouldn't be as good, that's for sure.
And in what respect? The vivid, the expansion of things, the connectedness? Because that strikes me in your book. You gave me a picture of the world where I thought, gee, everything is connected, even things that I don't know. And later, chaos theory came around and model theory, and then there was the famous story about the the butterfly in
Hawaii flaps its wings in Tokyo, and we get a hurricane
here
on the Gulf Coast. Yeah.
Yeah. So then science kind of said, yes, there is a connectedness, and then later on, you could put it in mystic terms and say, yeah, there is a connectedness between everything and everything, and those guys did. But you gave me that feeling that things are related that I wouldn't normally feel related. But is that also your own experience? I mean, did you write it because of your experience in your life?
Yeah, synchronicities sort of haunt me all my life.
Yeah.
I've always, maybe I'm more aware of them, or maybe they happen to me more often. That's a question that's hard to answer.
Remember, I called you about a week ago and I said, I would like to invite you on December 13th to come to Amsterdam. And you said, hey, I'm going to be in Amsterdam in a couple of days.
Yeah.
Synchronicity is there all the time. Yeah. Can we train that synchronicity? I mean, have you trained it? It feels, as you say, it happens to you, or is that genetic shamanism in the family?
Well, my mother used to read tea leaves.
So there is a lineage of reading the future.
I guess so, yeah.
But do you think that's how it works? It's kind of, we're trained to be what you could call shamanic or mystics or ESP people?
I don't know.
You don't know. Do you see yourself as having these powers?
Occasionally, but I don't know. I'm not very psychic, really, except accidentally and occasionally, but I do have an affinity for synchronicity. One of the things in Illuminatus that I did invent was Beethoven's membership in the Illuminati. I made that out of whole cloth. And then imagine my astonishment, I read a biography of Beethoven. And by God, if he wasn't a member of the Illuminati, all of his close friends were. He was certainly a Freemason and very closely associated with the Illuminati. I thought I invented that out of whole cloth. Is that unconscious telepathy? Or what? Is it just you occasionally hit something and you shoot at enough targets?
No, well, that's what I got from your books, is that there is a basic pattern of how things happen. And they don't happen because of people voting or whatever, but there's a whole mechanism in politics and in the world that makes things happen. And once you understand that, you can make the butterflies wings flap here and change big things. I remember the story, wasn't it, about the murder of Kennedy, where you wrote that there was a shaman or a medicine guy in Africa who heard about Kennedy, and he made a little puppet and said, "This guy has to die." Wasn't it part of the story?
No, it was another president in the story.
There was another president in the story, but that was the story.
The president in the novel isn't named because the novel is very carefully not set in any particular year. It's somewhere in the 1970s, sort of.
Yeah, and but anyway, you had this influence by an unknown African medicine doctor or whatever, a shaman, who decided...
Nkrumah Fubar was his name.
You remember. I remember the story because that gave me the idea that indeed magic plays a role today. Does it in politics?
Politics is full of magic. Look at the way, look at money, look at national flags. They all have magic symbols on them.
They were designed by people who were, as you say, part of the Illuminati.
The Irish £1 note has the Queen of the Fairies on it.
Well, yeah, but it makes sense if you go to Ireland and see all the green there, that the fairies are around.
Yeah, but all money has magic symbols on it. The United States dollar bill has the Illuminati pyramid on it. I haven't looked much at your Dutch money yet, but if I did, I'm
sure. We have birds on it these days.
Oh, birds. Well, that's what they're sacred to Venus.
Oh,
oh, no wonder you got birds. Amsterdam, red light district, Venus. Of course, it all makes sense.
Yeah. Actually, the more famous bill, actually, do I have one in my pocket, had one bird on it, and people would say you play with a snip, which is the name of the bird. So the thing became that. Just coming back on your latest book, so what is it? Everything is under control.
Everything is under control.
Okay. But that, in your view, doesn't mean we can sleep quietly.
I sleep very well.
But should be worried? I mean, we're going into the next millennium. Should we be worried about these powers that...
What millennium? Are you thinking of the Gregorian calendar?
Well, this is when my computer stops. Let's put it this way.
Oh, my computer is a Mac, so it's not going to stop. Oh. Anyway, I use the Poundian calendar.
This Poundian, which is...
Yeah, it was invented by Ezra Pound.
The poet.
Yeah, it starts on... October 30th, 1921, when Joyce wrote the last word of Ulysses. And this is the year, this is Hephaestus 2379 PSU. So you see, we've got over 921 years to go to the first millennium. In the Jewish calendar, you got about 400 years to the next millennium. In the Muslim calendar, you got about 600 years to the next millennium. The idea that we're approaching a millennium is based on the idea that Pope Gregory somehow invented the one true calendar. There is no one true calendar. Invent your own calendar. You see how easy it is. This is the year 3165 in the Discordian calendar, which gives us over 900 years to the next millennium, which will be the fourth. In the Mayan calendar, this is the year 5100 and something.
Katoon, yes.
So
but
you
where?
About 900 years to the next
yeah,
millennium.
But no, I think the Mayans believe that in the year 2012, something will happen, according
to
Terence.
A new cycle starts. Yeah.
But do you have a feeling that we're about to enter a new cycle?
Well, I feel that with information flow increasing all the time, it's not that we're entering a new cycle, it's that things are accelerating faster and faster.
But going towards some kind of crazy implosion or explosion?
I don't think so. I think they're just going to have to get used to things changing faster and faster.
But has it in reality changed? I mean, one of the things is the medical advances, yes? In fact, people don't grow very much older these days. Kids don't die that young. That's the story. But things like cancer and so on, we haven't conquered that. So is there real change?
Well, I don't know about this country, but in most of the world there's been a lot of change. Slavery was abolished in the United States about 150 years ago. Most people and most of the industrial world are living much better than their ancestors did 200 years ago. Serfdom has been abolished everywhere except China, I guess. No, several of them. It wasn't abolished in the Western world.
But what's like, for instance, internet? Do you think that's a big change?
Oh, absolutely.
Historically, we will look back and say the year, what was it, 93, 94, when the internet exploded, that was important?
I think so. In the United States, which I know more about than any other country, we had one official version of everything that happened in the news. The radio, television, newspapers, they all carried the same official party line. Now on internet, you get 1,001 versions of what happened. It's forcing people to choose and think, what's the evidence for this? What's the evidence for that? They're being forced to become smarter.
So it was really shaking, rattling the system.
Yeah.
The system of mind control.
No way has been found to impose one official reality on internet like the major media.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the one of the biggest changes in the 20th century, bigger than the atom bomb, probably.
And that's the internet. Now, there have been conspiracies on the internet, of course. Yeah, we have the viruses and those things. Are they widespread?
You know there are more fake virus warnings than real viruses.
I was part of the 1989 with Wes Thomas and lots of people from the States, Alan Lindell, of the fake October 13, which went as far that here at the police station, the police was handing out antivirus discs. Yes? And there was a virus, but it wasn't widespread. And so actually you could go to a police station and get an antivirus disc. It got that far, and Wes Thomas and Al Lindell would admit now that it was mostly fake. So
yeah,
I admit there was some conspiracy there.
Well, there was that guy in Hanover who found out from his home computer in Hanover, he was tapping into all the allegedly secure...
Yeah. This is the Wau Holland Chaos Computer Club.
Yeah.
Also involved in the October 13 scandal in those days.
Well, he was into the naval database in Norfolk, Lawrence Livermore Laboratories, where they're building super hydrogen bombs.
Yeah.
He was into every goddamn thing the United States government thought was secret. He was selling it to the KGB to support his cocaine habit. If one guy in Hanover could do that, how many others haven't been caught yet?
Yeah, I've always thought, if I could make... As a hacker, if I could make the bank account of the President of America or the President of Holland or whatever increase by 1 cent every day, just every day 1 cent would be added, you know, like a clock. And he couldn't stop it. But like every day from some angle, 1 cent would be added to his thing. That would be the ultimate hacker stunt.
Why do you
because
want to add a cent instead of taking a cent
just
away?
to make sure it's not dangerous. I'm not stealing really, but I'm making sure, guy, we have you under control.
I'd rather you arrange things so that his salary check comes to me and my salary check goes to him.
Yeah.
Except
but that,
I don't get salary.
But that would end very quickly because real money would go. Yeah. Okay. Well, what do you think about the cannabis cup? Because we're here for the cannabis cup.
Oh, I think it's a wonderful... It reminds me that civilization does exist on this planet after all. That's what Amsterdam always makes me think of every time I come here.
Well, civilization, I find it rather tribal. I mean, it's a group of people that know each other, they come together, they travel half the world to be here.
Well, the cannabis club may be tribal, but Amsterdam itself is civilized. If you come from the United States, you'll know what I mean.
Well, that's a compliment. Especially from the mouth of Robert and Wilson, Illuminati author, and now your latest book is Everything is Under Control. If you are interested in conspiracies, in samenzweringen, read the books, and this is the man. Thank you, Bob.
You're welcome. What do I do now?
Nothing. You get the tape from us. Yeah?
I get what?
You get a tape with the interview.